As we predicted yesterday, there would not be a lot of people here today. One of our colleagues died last week, and the funeral is this morning. So we have a lot of people who didn't come for that reason. And the important thing is that we are producing this conference for the web. So people who didn't get to come today will get to see it regardless. And we will be setting this up so that each of our speakers gets a copy of the entire presentations and everybody else's handouts in the binder and that kind of thing. So it has been a wonderful day. Yesterday was fabulous. I don't think anybody would disagree with that. It was great, and it was one of the finest days, as Michael Katz said, in the 23 years that he's been attending these conferences almost. He's been going that long. Yesterday was the best day. So that means that the program is an excellent program, and we're going to have another great day. And in fact, we're going to start with a mini symposium this morning, as you can see from your outline. And the first presenter is Dr. Bandana Chatterjee, and she is a professor in the Department of Cellular and Structural Biology at the University of Texas Health Science Center at San Antonio, and also senior career scientist with the Department of Veterans Affairs in Washington, and a research health scientist in our GREC, our Geriatric Research, Education, and Clinical Center in our very own South Texas Veterans Healthcare System. She's certainly been a lecturer for our Geriatric Education Center at the school for a number of years as well. And this year she was selected to receive the Dean's Exceptional Graduate Teaching Award at the Health Science Center. And I have to tell you that that is an incredible honor. Those are rare and tough to get, and you've got to be really good to get one. And in addition, in 67, she was selected to receive a National Science Talent Search Award from the government of India. They earmarked her that early and has continued receiving extensive awards and recognition for her many illustrious accomplishments. And she's earned, even as a student, she was first in her class in just about everything. And it's a real honor to have her give our first talk of the morning. Thank you.
That's it?
That's good. You don't have to talk real loud.
Well, Michelle, thank you so much for that such generous introduction. I must tell you, without Michelle, this conference couldn't happen. Michelle, Dr. Saunders spent hours every night pulling into long hours, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning, trying to fix the PowerPoint presentations for all of us. So Michelle, all of us, the speakers, are just eternally grateful to you for your dedication. Well, thank you all for coming so early on a Saturday morning today. I want to thank Dr. Michael Katz and the GREC Organizing Committee for asking me to talk here this morning to talk about our studies that are directed to understand how different regulatory pathways interact to cause initiation of prostatic lesions that over time progresses through various histologic stages to develop into prostate tumor and benign prostate hyperplasia. Today, this morning, I will focus on the role of androgen receptor in the development of prostate cancer and prostatic hyperplasia. Based on a transgenic mouse model that we have developed in our laboratory, I will present evidence to show that targeted overexpression of androgen receptor in the mouse prostate is sufficient to cause initiation of prostatic lesions. Now, as we heard yesterday many times, that androgen is essential for the development of prostate cancer and benign prostate hyperplasia. As a matter of fact, the drug finasteride, which inhibits formation of DHT from testosterone in the prostatic tissue, the finasteride is used to treat BPH. And as we learned from Dr. Ian Thompson yesterday, that finasteride is currently being tested for its potential to be used as a drug to prevent development and progression of prostate cancer, and we'll have to wait till 2004 to know the outcome of that study. So the bottom line is androgen is essential for development of prostatic pathology. However, within the cell, it's the androgen receptor that mediates androgen action. So androgen receptor is really a critical regulatory protein in this process of prostatic function. So just a short briefing on androgen receptor. It's a transcription factor that has to go to the nucleus from the cytoplasm to do its job as a regulatory protein to turn on a number of genes that are involved in the promotion of prostate cell growth. But for androgen receptor to be functionally active, it has to first bind to the hormone, the androgen, that is DHT in this case, and the hormone is bound to the carboxyl terminal of the protein. Also, I like to note that at the front part of the protein, typically known as the N-terminal domain, there is a stretch of glutamine residues. It's called Q repeats or polyglutamine repeats. And that turns out to be very important in the context of prostatic pathology. Normally, there are about 21 residues of glutamine residues, repeat of glutamine residues on the androgen receptor, and that's okay, that's good. But sometimes, if these glutamine residues expand to something about 40 residues or more, then that particular male individual would have increased risk for developing prostatic pathology. So as I said, that androgen receptor in its inactive form stays in the cytoplasm, and once it binds to its ligand, that is the hormone DHT, then it is translocated from the cytoplasm to the nucleus. And as a matter of fact, we have done a lot of work to understand the regulatory factors that are involved in this translocation process. This particular slide shows the freeze frame images of androgen receptor being translocated from the cytoplasm into the nucleus. What we have done here, this is live cell experiment. The receptor protein itself is labeled by green fluorescence. So at 0 point, the receptor is all in the cytoplasm, and after the androgen DHT is added to the cell culture medium, the receptor slowly moves into the nucleus, and by about 45 minutes, 90% or more of the receptor is already in the nucleus. Now, so androgen receptor in the prostate, androgen receptor plays an essential role in the proliferation and differentiation of prostate epithelial cells. The cartoon slide here at the right depicts a schematics of the functional unit of a prostate gland. This unit has the epithelial compartment and the stromal compartment. In the epithelial compartment, the major cell population is the secretory epithelial cells or luminal epithelial cells. These are the cells that are terminally differentiated, and they are the one they produce prostate-specific antigen, that is PSA, and prostate-specific phosphatase, those kind of proteins that are then secreted into the ductal lumen. And then there are also basal epithelial cells. And these basal epithelial cells, they are able to, in response to androgenic signal mediated via androgen receptor, these basal epithelial cells can proliferate and differentiate and finally form the secretory epithelial cells. So what happens is that when the differentiated cells become damaged or non-functional, then they are culled out of the cell population through a process known as programmed cell death or apoptosis. So So you can imagine that, you know, androgen receptor really is very important in the normal, in maintaining the normal development and function of the prostatic tissue. What happens upon castration, about 90% of the secretory epithelial cells, they die by apoptosis. And then those castrated animals, if they are stimulated by androgenic administration, then these basal cells, basal epithelial cells, then they go through the proliferative phase and differentiation phase to generate new secretory epithelial cells and to restore glandular structure. And then in the stromal component, there are a number of different cell types, such as fibroblasts, smooth muscle cells, nerve cells, endothelial cells, and then a sort of cells such as mast cells and lymphocytes. So the bottom line then is that the androgen receptor is essential to maintain developmental normal function of the prostatic tissue. But then something goes wrong, and that then begins to create problem, and prostatic pathology shows up. As one can imagine, that under normal physiology, there is an equilibrium, steady state equilibrium, between the rate of cell proliferation in the prostate, rate of cell proliferation, and rate of apoptosis, because apoptosis itself is a normal process that takes place to take care of the damaged differentiated cells so that the tissue can function normally. But then, under a proliferative pathology, you know, when the lesion problem starts, then you have increased rate of cell proliferation and decreased rate of apoptosis, and that causes pathology. Now, one way this disequilibrium between proliferation and apoptosis can take place is through activation of specific intracellular signaling pathways, as described quite extensively by Dr. Kreisberg yesterday in his talk. And two of the signaling pathways, namely the MAP kinase pathway and the AKT signaling pathway, these two pathways have been very clearly linked to the androgen receptor pathway in the prostate cells through experiments. Now I got it. So just to illustrate the point a little bit further, so here you have the androgen signaling in the cell. Androgen comes from outside the cell into the cell and, you know, interacts with its receptor, androgen receptor, which then goes to the nucleus. This is the normal androgen signaling pathway. And then when specific cell surface receptors, such as the members of the EGF receptor family, they are stimulated, and this stimulation can take place by different mitogenic stimuli like growth factor, radiation, oxidative damage, free radicals, etc. Then either the RAF, MEK, ARC pathway gets activated, this is the MAP kinase pathway, or the AKT signaling pathway can be activated. And both of these pathways, now there are clear experimental evidence to show that both of these pathways can increase androgen receptor transcriptional activity, which in turn would then promote androgen-induced cell growth. And then these two pathways themselves are survival pathway. They can inhibit apoptotic function by inhibiting specific pro-apoptotic proteins such as caspase-9, BAD, etc. And they by themselves can cause survival of the cell, and they also can crosstalk with androgen signaling so that the androgen-induced cell growth could also increase. So these are different ways then cell the normal balance between the proliferation and apoptosis could be disrupted under different types of cell surface receptor events, and that could create problem.
Don't click on that. Close that file and open presentation to the bottom and load your own file. I just saw it.
You loaded the wrong file?
Yeah, so click on there. Don't click on that.
Where do I click?
Just click on the screen.
In here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Click again.
I thought you did the right thing. Click again.
All right, now go to the bottom of the where it says presentations, and click on that.
Where is the presentation?
Way at the bottom. Should be a...
Sorry. No, that's okay, but I thought it was all set.
I didn't load the final.
Oh, but that's okay.
Well, fortunately, we can edit this out of the tape.
But anyway, so let's just go ahead. Oh.
Okay, here you go. Chatterjee, it's the final one.
Well, but let's just go final three. It's okay, I can manage.
All right.
I'll manage.
Sorry.
No, don't be sorry. You have been so helpful. So where was I? So I was talking about crosstalk between androgen signaling and MAP kinase and AKT signaling. Okay, so one of our goals in the lab has been to develop animal models that would, I think we got it, didn't we? Okay, so let's just go to the next. Let's go to slideshow.
There you go.
So we'll just skip that. So one of the goals in my lab has been to develop animal models that would show prostatic lesions, which would progressively go through different histologic stages from pre-cancerous stage to partly cancerous stage to localized cancer stage and then to metastatic aggressive stage. And our goal is to identify molecular hits that are necessary above and beyond abnormal androgen receptor function to cause these progressive histologic changes from a very benign state to all the way to a very aggressive metastatic stage. Last year, there was some report showing that in a patient population, 96 patients who have undergone radical prostatectomy, the level of androgen receptor expression in the tumor epithelium, malignant epithelium of the prostate, directly correlates with the clinical stages of the tumor, also directly correlates with the relapse time. Higher the androgen receptor expression in the epithelium of the tumor, the malignant epithelium, more chance it is that quicker there would be the relapse time, and also this higher androgen receptor expression correlates increased higher pretreatment PSA levels. So what we did, we decided to create a mouse model where androgen receptor will be specifically overexpressed in the prostate tissue via prostate-specific promoters. We used PSA gene promoter, the prostate-specific gene promoter, and we created a mouse, which we call PSA-AR mouse. And so here, the construct, the transgene construct that was used to create the mouse is shown here. Here is the PSA gene promoter that is hooked in front of the androgen receptor cDNA, and there are some regulatory sequences we attach so that we'll get very strong expression of the transgene in the prostate. And analysis showed there are about 50 copies of the transgene integrated into the mouse genome. We don't have to go into the details of this slide, but basically, by a variety of ways, we showed that there is indeed high expression of androgen receptor gene in these transgenic mice, specifically in the prostate, compared to the non-transgenic littermate. And for example, if you just look at this figure here, you would see that there is about fivefold or more higher expression of androgen receptor messenger RNA in the transgene prostate compared to the non-transgene prostate. And this is a real-time PCR data giving you about the same degree or fold stimulation, which is about fivefold. And at the protein level, through Western blot, we could see that there is also about same level of increase in the androgen immunoreactive androgen receptor level in the prostate. Now, But the striking feature of these mice that we found was that there was this striking histopathology in the prostate of these transgenic mice. These transgenic mice showed very high degree of prostate hyperplasia, restricted to the dorsolateral lobe of the prostate. So here is the dorsolateral histology of the dorsolateral lobe of a wild-type mouse prostate. It looks very normal. But when you look at the transgenic mouse prostate, you see there is extensive hyperproliferation of the prostate epithelial cell. There is so much proliferation of these cells that the ductal lumen is almost filled with all these epithelial cells. And I will go into this a little later and explain a little more. But the other striking feature was that there is tremendous stromal expansion in the transgenic mouse. And if you take a closer look at the proliferating area, the hyperplastic area of the prosthetic tissue, you see a nuclear enlargement, hyperchromasia, and these cells are positive for androgen receptor as indicated by this brown stain. Now, also, when we immunohistochemically stain these areas, dorsal prostate, with for prostate-specific nuclear antigen, PSA-AR, which is a marker for cell proliferation, we could see about fivefold increase in PSA-AR expression in the transgenic mouse prostate as compared to the wild-type prostate. Now, the interesting thing about this pathology is that, as I mentioned earlier, the pathology is restricted to the dorsolateral lobe of the prostate. And the dorsolateral lobe of the mouse prostate is very similar to the transitional zone and peripheral zone of the human prostate. And it's this area of the human prostate, which is the transitional zone, that's where the BPH, benign prostate hyperplasia, develops. So there is a lot of similarity in the pathology we are seeing in our PSA-AR mouse prostate with the human BPH hyperplasia that one sees clinically. And we are quite excited about that. But we want to understand, being a basic scientist, our major goal is to understand what is going wrong in the regulatory pathway that would result in this kind of lesion. So what we did, our goal was to understand the regulatory pathways that are being altered as a result of overexpression of androgen receptor in the mouse prostate. So we took advantage of microarray-based analysis, which is an analysis that would allow one to identify a wide variety of genes that would undergo changes in expression as a result of a particular experimental manipulation. And we actually didn't see in our, this is quite preliminary data, but we really didn't see too many changes in too many genes. However, some of the genes that looked really interesting to us, they are hyperplasia related. For example, there's a RAF-related proto-oncogene that was increased by about 2.5-fold. Interesting thing, metric metalloproteinase 9 was upregulated by 2.3-fold. And I might mention in the clinical setting, it's metric metalloproteinase 9 is also upregulated in the advanced stage of prostate cancer. And now, for any microarray data, one must carry out post hoc analysis to validate the results. And I'll show you just one example of such post hoc analysis. And for example, before I have mentioned here that the plasminogen activator is upregulated by 2.4-fold, and peroxidoxin is downregulated by 1.4-fold. And that could be again validated through this kind of RT-PCR data, where you see that in the case of plasminogen activator, there is upregulation in the transgenic mice, and in the case of peroxidoxin, there is downregulation of the expression of this gene in the transgenic mice. Okay. So we have these PSA-AR mice that are overexpressing androgen receptors, specifically in the prostate. They are showing pathology, but they are hyperplastic pathology. The pathology we have actually examined as old as 10-month-old mice. So even then, the pathology stays at the hyperplastic stage. It doesn't progress to the next stage. I might also say that these mice, they are 100% penetrant for their pathology. But then the next question is that, so what are the additional molecular hits that would be necessary to go to the next stage, that is the stage of dysplasia, and then the next stage, that is the stage of localized cancer, a neoplasia, and then finally the very next stage, which is the metastatic invasive neoplasia. So can we identify such molecular hits? That's the goal for the lab right now. And one approach we are taking, we also have mice that are overexpressing the anti-apoptotic protein BCL2, specifically in the prostate. But these BCL2 expressing mice, they do not show any pathology. But we are now breeding these BCL2 overexpressing mice with the PSA-AR mice to see if you have two hits, that is overexpression of androgen receptor on top of that overexpression of the anti-apoptotic protein BCL2, would that then progress, make the pathology progress to the next stage? And another very interesting data we just got this week, and so I don't have slide for it, is that we also have created mice, PSA-AR mice, that have been knocked out for P53, the tumor suppressor protein P53. So these are PSA-AR mice under the P53 inactivated background. And you can create these mice through appropriate breeding strategy. And what we saw, very interesting, the data are very preliminary. We have to do many more mice and, you know, analyze the pathology to confirm our results. However, what we saw that in these PSA-AR mice inactivated for P53 function, P53 is a tumor suppressor protein, these mice, they develop pathology much earlier. Usually the PSA-AR mice would develop pathology by about 5 months of age, whereas these PSA-AR mice that are inactivated for P53 tumor suppressor function, they show pathology by about 2 to 3 months of age. Not only that, the pathology is much more extensive and looks like, the preliminary data shows, looks like the pathology has progressed to the next stage, which is the stage of dysplasia. So these are the kind of approaches we are taking to understand the additional molecular hits that would be necessary for these initial prostatic lesions to progress through various histologic stages. So the other aspect of work in our lab that's going on is we are trying to explore the rational therapeutic strategies to the problem of prostate cancer and benign prostate hyperplasia. Toward that end, we have developed androgen receptor specific ribozyme. Ribozymes are specific type of enzymes. These are not protein enzymes, but these are RNA enzymes. And these enzymes can specifically inactivate androgen receptor function by degrading androgen receptor messenger RNAs. This is the cover picture of the article that we published in Molecular Endocrinology about 2 to 3 years ago. But basically what it shows in a cartoon fashion, here is the androgen receptor messenger RNA, and here is the hammerhead ribozyme designed specifically to act only on androgen receptor messenger RNA, but no other messenger RNA, and there will be a single point cleavage, cleaving the androgen receptor messenger RNA, and this messenger RNA will be degraded. And just to give you just a little bit of data, and here is the cleavage data, where androgen receptor messenger RNA, designated here by S, has been incubated with our hammerhead ribozyme. And you can see by 45 minutes, there is almost complete degradation of the upper band and giving two lower bands, which are the two cleavage products. Can you see? Or it's all black? OK. They're OK? They're all black? Anyway, I don't know, because I can't see from here. I can see on my computer. But basically what it is that this ribozyme, hammerhead ribozyme, specific for androgen receptor, when cells are, when these ribozymes are introduced into prostate cancer cell, then the androgen receptor positive cells could be specifically inactivated for androgen receptor expression by about 24 hours. So we are actually collaborating with a group in University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill to see the efficacy of this androgen receptor specific ribozyme in the in vivo, whether it can slow down the progression of prostate cancer. And we are using a xenograft model to test that. And preliminary results so far have been extremely encouraging. So finally, I would end by saying that this work was done in collaboration with the laboratory of Professor Arun Roy at UT Health Science Center. Dr. Chung Song, he is my long-term collaborator, and he really has made the critical contribution with regard to developing and characterizing the PSA-AR mice. The fellows listed here, all of them really have made important, played a very important role in the development of this project. Thank you very much, and I would be happy to address any questions that you might have. That involved National Human Genome Research Institute. And Dr. Naylor is course organizer, currently teaching mammalian genomics, functional genomics. And Dr. Naylor received Magna Cum Laude distinction while completing a bachelor in biology. And then she earned a master's MA in biology from Johns Hopkins University, and then a PhD in human genetics from University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston. I might add that we were so pleased to see Dr. Naylor's long-term research contributions have been recently recognized by our university by giving her the Presidential Distinguished Research Award. And we are really happy that Dr. Naylor is going to share with us her recent findings from the lab.
Oops, breaking your equipment. Okay, Chatterjee. I got it. Except. Thank you very much for that kind introduction, Bandana. And I would like to thank Michael Katz and the organizers for inviting me to speak today. It's unfortunate that we had such a tragic happening that many couldn't be here. I am actually speaking in combination with Robin Leach. Robin Leach is in Chile now with her daughter, who's presenting at the International Science Fair. So I'm going to present her work as well as mine. So if I stumble a little bit, it's because even though Robin and I work closely together, I don't know everything she does. So today I'm going to talk about what happens in the population. There are variations in the very genes that we've been hammering to death over the last day or so, and the variations occur naturally in the population. Consequently, we're trying to find markers that are indicative of having a risk for prostate cancer. To facilitate our work, and we've been working with Ian Thompson with the SABOR program. SABOR is San Antonio's branch of the Early Detection Network that we heard about yesterday. Basically, they're enrolling 10,000 men into this program to monitor them over the years and to see which of the men developed prostate cancer and assess different markers as markers of risk for prostate cancer. We've been enrolling patients since March of last year. And as you can see, we obtain our patients from a variety of locations around town. We find that since San Antonio is in a unique situation, we have such a high minority base for Hispanics, and we have a good black population to recruit from as well, that we really want to have this the shining star for getting data on minority populations. Consequently, we've also found that the way you obtain minority populations and enroll them in your studies is a little bit different than trying to hit the people that normally you interact with at the clinic. We've been able to successfully bring in a lot of people. Here's a map of the San Antonio area. As you can see, most of our patients, or not patients, I would say enrollees, are coming from all over the area, out as far as Austin. And we have a few people from way far away that heard about us through the internet. And in town, you can see we have a distribution all over town. We're trying to avoid the clustering of recruiting on the north side of San Antonio by the Health Science Center, because we would not hit our target population if we kept recruiting in that area. So as you can see, we have an age distribution for those enrolling in the subor population. Unfortunately, we are not catching the elderly, which is the object of this particular conference. But I'm sure as time goes on, since we've only to date recruited 1,500 men, and our target is much higher, we will have representation in the elderly. So what are the risk cancers for prostate cancer? Diet, obviously, there are a lot of studies around how diet, smoking, alcohol, sexual behavior, and of course age is a big factor, is a risk factor. But we want to talk about today's ethnicity and somewhat family history. Obviously, coming with ethnicity are a set of genes that are unique to that population. Consequently, we're trying to look at this, and we've seen this three or four times over the last few days, but different ethnic groups do have different incidence of prostate cancer and mortality rates. Now, we've heard this, the black population estimate is inflated, but the black population does have a much higher risk. And most significantly for San Antonio, the Hispanic population has a lower risk for prostate cancer. We want to determine whether there's some genetic basis for this lower risk in the Hispanic population. As you can see in Sabor, when we first were recruiting, we actually got a very large part of the white population enrolling. So we worked very hard to recruit the African-American population and the Hispanic population into the program. And actually, these two areas are the ones that are expanding now that we have a better clue on how to recruit. Obviously, there's not that many Asian-Americans in San Antonio or Native Americans, so that our accrual is very low in these areas. Well, is there a hereditary component to prostate cancer? And not just prostate cancer families, but prostate cancer in general. This is a study that was done in Sweden using the Scandinavian registries. In Scandinavia, you are tracked your whole life. Your medical history has been put in these huge registries. And one of the most valuable resources they have are twin registries. And by looking at twins, you can tell whether a disease, and any disease, but in this case, prostate cancer and other cancers, have a genetic component. In other words, if you are an identical twin, and there is a genetic component, there'll be a very high percentage of both twins having the disease. And so by using some statistics that I don't understand that well, they estimate that 42% of the risk for prostate cancer comes from genetic factors. Well, there are some well-known factors. There are families that do have inherited mutations in single genes that cause prostate cancer. There's one on chromosome 1 called RNase L, and there's one on chromosome 17 called ELECT 2, but there's a variety of other ones that have been located on a chromosome, but they don't know what the genes are. These and the incident of prostate cancer and breast cancer families account for a very small part of all the prostate cancer cases. So even though there are some real strong genes that have an effect and end up causing prostate cancer, that doesn't account for all the genetic variation that ends up playing a role in prostate cancer. My lab and Robin Leach's lab also study genes that go bad in cancer. But what I want to talk about today are the genes that we've been studying that vary normally in the population. And if you get a set of variants, all of a sudden you're at risk for prostate cancer. So some of these things are common polymorphisms seen in prostate-related genes. And of course, one of those genes, Bandana just spoke of, the androgen receptor, there are variants of the androgen receptor that has increased risk for prostate cancer. So androgens also obviously have a role in prostate cancer. And as Ian mentioned yesterday, the gene 5-alpha reductase has a variant which is associated with prostate cancer risk. And so consequently, there are several genes. You saw this pathway yesterday where you get the production of testosterone, and hydroxytestosterone. And there are four genes shown here that we've studied that have variants in the population, and we tried to see whether having a variant was a risk factor in having prostate cancer. Now, how do we look at variants? Okay, the most common way to look at variants are, one, SNPs. SNP stands for single nucleotide polymorphism. Excuse me. In this case, this is just a DNA sequencing run. Normally, which I can't see from here, right around there, people have a T. And in some individuals, they'll have both in some individuals, they'll have a G and an A. That is, they'll be heterozygous. They have two copies, two chromosomes, one having an A and one having a G. Well, these single nucleotide polymorphisms can often result in the substitution of one amino acid in the protein for another. So when you have a change like that, somehow the protein doesn't act exactly the way it used to act. Other polymorphism was mentioned by Bandana are the link polymorphisms in the androgen receptor. The androgen receptor actually has two different repetitive areas, one CAG and one GGC, and they will get bigger and bigger and bigger, or smaller, shown here. And this is just a gel showing the big ones are up here and the small ones are down here. So you can have many repeats or a few repeats. Both of these repeats have been examined for the androgen receptor. Well, first, we're going to talk about who we look at. So we've collected 1,500 people with Sabor, and part of collecting the samples from Sabor, individuals that are being screened have a digital rectal examination, and they have their PSA determined. In this routine collection of individuals for Sabor, we've identified 10 patients that actually had prostate cancer. And I'm sure as we watch this population age, we'll see more cases developing. But obviously, this is not a good enough sample to do any kind of study. So consequently, we've been using other samples that we've collected at the Health Science Center. Dean Troyer is a pathologist that has developed a repository of prostate cancer samples from prostatectomies. And we have data to identify the people's ethnicity and age of diagnosis. And we have the ideal set of controls, because all the people in Sabor, which we can use as controls, are definitely negative by a digital rectal exam and have a PSA less than 2.5. So one of the genes we showed there was CYP17. CYP17 has shown to have a significant correlation in Austrian and Japanese populations, but it's been inconsistent in the literature. So what we were trying to find out, whether Hispanics and whites have different incidence of the CYP17 polymorphism. And in this case, we found no difference between Hispanics and whites. So this didn't account for the fact that Hispanics are much less risk than whites for prostate cancer. And another negative data came along. There are four SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, in HSD3B2. And this particular gene is has a higher risk with familial prostate cancer. Unfortunately, there's no difference between Hispanics and whites and with this gene either. And all these SNP data shown here are from Robin Leach's lab. And so as you can imagine, as they kept going through known polymorphisms, known to have risk in other populations, we went again with SRD5A2, or the 5-alpha reductase. And as you can see, this is highly associated with metastatic disease, but yet there's no difference between Hispanics and white. So we thought, well, we're getting to the point where this is getting to be very frustrating. So she decided to look at the androgen receptor gene. And as Bandana showed you, there are two repeat areas shown here. And this repeat has been looked in other studies where shorter repeats have increased risk, but there has never been any Hispanic studies. So when Robin looked at the cases that we have in San Antonio, what she saw was that the majority of people with cancer have a shorter number of repeats, where it was a less likely, if you had a lot of repeats, to have cancer. And so the age-adjusted odds ratio, that is, of having it or not having it, is 3. So you have a 3 times higher risk if you have a short androgen receptor. This is actually the number of repeats as shown by ethnic group. Blacks, it is known, that have a higher risk for prostate cancer. And on the average, they have shorter repeats. Whites, shown here, are intermediate to Hispanics, and Hispanics are less likely to have a prostate cancer, and they have the longest repeats. So this correlates very well between the rates of having prostate cancer and the length of the repeats. Obviously, this is not enough to account for everything. And this is what's happening with these studies, is that it seems like it's a summation of a whole lot of little factors that end up making a person more or less likely to be a risk for prostate cancer. Well, I would like to talk about my work in a new gene family that we've been working on, and these are the semaphorin genes. I'm sure many of you have not even heard of it, but they're signaling molecules that have some origin in neurosciences, but they're generally signaling in a lot of different pathways in the cell. And my lab has done a lot of work to look at the semaphorin gene family to find their role in different cancers. And actually, we've done a lot of work in lung cancer and in ovarian cancer. The family we're using here is the semaphorin 3 family, and there are two genes, semaphorin 3F and semaphorin 3B. These are very closely related genes, and they're right next to each other on the chromosome. So we had noted before that this is a lot of lab data, but if you look at the lab, and you look at a bunch of different types of tumors, this is a fibrosarcoma, ovarian cancer, or lung cancer, you'll see that these genes are tumor suppressor genes. If you, they're normally missing in tumors. If you put them back in the tumor in the lab setting, you'll find they stop growth and soft auger, which is an indication that the cell's more controlled. Or if you look at an animal shown here, normally the tumors grow very well in nude mice. But if you turn this gene back on, it'll stop growing in nude mice and you'll get total control of the cell line again, and it behaves much more normally. SEMA3F has a slightly different spectrum of tumors that it works on than SEMA3B. But both have variants. SEMA3F, we found when we cloned the gene, could have either a methionine or a leucine at amino acid 471. This is a SNP. It's just a single change in the DNA that results in this amino acid. Well, doing some of the lab studies that I just mentioned to you, normally, if you put semaphorin, whoops, we lost something here, but that's all right. If we put semaphorin into a tumor cell line, the tumor does not any longer grow in nude mice. In other words, you inject it and it just sits there and it never grows out again. Part of this region is that there is a connection between semaphorin and the VEGF gene, which is involved in vascularization. However, if you have the leucine form, or you don't put anything in, tumors just pop up and grow in the animal. So this is a normal variation in the population. And in fact, 70% of you have the bad leucine form, whereas 30% have the methionine form. So we decided to look, oops, there it is. There's methionine and here's leucine. Okay, so we decided to look at, first of all, is there a difference between Hispanics, blacks, and whites at this polymorphism? And as you can see here, the blacks have a different distribution than the whites and Hispanics. So this looked promising, at least they weren't the same. And shown here is what happens in tumors. You can have because you have two genes, you have two chromosomes, you can have two methionines, a methionine and a leucine, or two leucines. If there are two leucines in shown in this column, and people that are white and blue or Hispanic and red, this is people without tumors, and the solid bars are people with tumors. There's not much difference. If people with or without tumors get as many tumors. And the same thing as having one methionine and one leucine. But if you have two methionines, the risk of getting a tumor is much less. In other words, it's a good gene, it's protective. And consequently, there's like an eightfold less probability that you would get prostate cancer if you were had methionine, that this particular amino acid. Well, these are all brand new data. They have not been published yet, but we're working greatly with Sabor to obtain other samples with a repository and Dean Troyer to actually prove that there is a protective effect with semaphorin. So in addition to the genes that we've been looking at, and many people have looking at in androgen metabolism, we're also adding our own genes and other genes that we've identified along the way. And what we want to do is come up with a composite and try to figure out what is the best way. Remember yesterday Ian said what we would like to do was do a test at a certain age and say, from here on, you don't have to worry about prostate cancer. You've got a whole set of good genes. This is so popular that it's even in the press now. Early detection is where it's at as far as different cancers, including prostate cancer. We looked at PSA many times, and so many times nobody wants to talk about it again. PSA has value. PSA detection has had an impact on the field. Maybe in combination with the markers that we find, maybe if you put all these data together, you can get a more valid test, something that would be much more indicative of not only whether someone have disease, but how bad it's going to be, how life-threatening it's going to be. So consequently, we're want to put all these data together and compare different ethnic groups to see if we can come up with a set of markers that are good to use for all men. And the EDRN, this is really their goal in prostate cancer and other cancers. We would like to understand, even though we showed blacks have a higher incidence of prostate cancer, the number of families with prostate cancer is lower. So maybe it's all the addition of all these small variants, not one big gene, that makes a difference in this situation. I'd like to thank all the people that work in my lab and in Robin's lab. As I said, Robin did much of the work on the androgen receptor and other genes involved in androgen metabolism. Brad Pollack, without whom I would know not exactly what was significant. I can tell something significant when I look at it, but he does the statistics. And of course, Dean Troyer and Ian Thompson, who have been doing all the work in collecting samples for us. Thank you very much.